wait. The music just suddenly stopped on our end, so hopefully audio is going out. We'll have to see. Welcome to Foreign Bodies. I am Timothy Harvey.
Hello, Leslie Walker.
And this is Sci-Fi for Me, show about horror from across the seas. Yes, folks, it's foreign horror films. And I imagine we're going to branch out into other foreign horror media once we make our way through all of the horror films that have ever been out from across the seas. Two or three more episodes. We'll have them all covered.
I was just thinking we could be doing this show until we're dead.
Oh, hey, you know what? That's okay. I got plenty of foreign horror films I can line up until it's my time to push up the daisies. That's absolutely fine. This episode, we are looking at the Fangoria Chainsaw Awards, the 2021 awards for their, and the awards have been given, and there's, of course, a long range of different aspects of horror that were judged in this particular competition. And of course, it's a fan-voted award. So of course, you know, feedback from horror fans, that's how it's meant to be. We, of course, are focusing, because, you know, that's what this show is about, on the foreign horror films. And it's quite the interesting list they had this year. And from a variety of locations, which is always nice. And one of which we have already talked about on this very show. In one of the earliest episodes of Foreign Bodies, we talked about the film Sputnik, of course, which is Russian. We've got Bacurau, which I think is the correct pronunciation. I'm probably mangling it, and my apologies. It is a film that was produced, set in Brazil. It's a Brazilian and French co-production. You've got La Llorona, not the curse of La Llorona. You have to make a distinction there between the two. And let's see, where is that set?
Guatemala.
Guatemala, thank you very much. Blood Quantum, which is a Canadian horror film. And I'm leaving one, Impetigore, which is Indonesian. And so it's an interesting range of countries, and it's an interesting range of films. And those are the nominees. Now, the winner is La Llorona. What we thought we would do this episode is consider these films and ask ourselves, should La Llorona have actually won the best of the films? Because second-guessing award shows is...
It's the greatest American pastime.
Exactly. And you know, did they get it right? Did they get it wrong? Why on earth would you... Why on earth would this film have won? Are they crazy? Well... Give you an answer on that, I imagine. So yeah. So first up, since we've already covered Sputnik, we thought we'd start with that one, mostly because kind of get it out of the way. If you want to like a full in-depth version of Sputnik, go back in our catalog. Have you not watched all of our episodes already? Well, you should. Sputnik, of course, is a Russian horror film, which is I quite enjoyed. It's very Western influenced. There's a lot of alien in it. There's a lot of just, it's got a very Western feel to it. And of course, because it seems so heavily influenced by Western science fiction and horror, the fact that it's getting an American remake, I mean, there's like a certain amount of drilling down into yourself here. I'm not sure what this is going to turn into, but I mean, it's an astronaut goes out, brings something back. It gets bloody, you know, exactly what you would expect from this kind of movie. And it's a solid science fiction horror thriller with some interesting characters and some interesting creature design. And I, you know, it's a quite enjoyable, solid science fiction horror movie. I don't have, there wasn't anything about it that I remember disliking. And so I think it's definitely something, I mean, it does something that all of these films do, which I really appreciated, is that it lets characters breathe. And the current crop of American horror doesn't always do that.
No.
There's a whole lot of, you know, story's got to go forward at breakneck pace. We have to have super quick cuts. You know, the edit the films all to hell just because it's got to be just bam, 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 bam. And I'm a big fan of letting the scene and the tension build. The Carpenter school of, you know, that Halloween, of course, is a fantastic example of. It's just let nothing happen for a long time until you're just on the edge of your seat and you're about to snap. That's my, there's a place for the hyper-violent, hyper-kinetic horror, and there's times I like that too. But I do appreciate the fact that all of these films will at least take a moment to sit there and go, let's be still. And Sputnik does the same. So, I mean, it's a good film. So, I mean, I certainly think it's, you know, it being on the list of you know, competitors for the award, I'm perfectly fine with that.
Yes. I mean, you and I talked briefly about it before we started recording today's session, that you had gone back and rewatched it, and I didn't. I like the movie just fine. I think you maybe like it a little bit more than I did. And in the grand scheme of things, I think it was one of those movies. Yep, I watched it. It was good enough. You know, I don't regret having wasted that hour and a half, 2 hours of my time, but I don't really feel like I need to go watch it again. So, you know, there it is. I do like the strong female lead. We talked probably ad nauseum when we did our coverage of Sputnik back in, I think the episode aired November 28th, if memory serves. And at the time, I think I personally waxed on and on about how cool the building was that most of the action took place in. Like, for me, that building was the star of the show. It just such an incredibly
brutalist Soviet architecture.
Yes, it was like stereotyped without feeling cliche, if you know what I mean.
Right.
And so it's such a kind of broody building. But yeah, it was great. Story was interesting. Like I said, it's enough of a Western feel to kind of feel familiar, but because it's also distinctly Russian, it also brings a little slightly different aesthetic quality to it. So yes, very much worth a watch. Didn't feel like I needed to watch it again.
And that's okay. Some films are like that. Some films, you want to go back and watch them again and again and again. Not every film needs to be that movie. All right, so that's the one we had seen before, but all the other four films were all new to me. It was always really nice to explore new things, and certainly stuff that's, you know, we spend a lot of time diving back into the history of some of these countries that we talk about their horror catalog. And so we don't always look at the newest things in, you know, this is always nice to focus on a set of the newer films. Now, these films run from 2019 up through 2020. Of course, the pandemic, you know, and release schedules and all that sort of thing affected, you know, obviously affected them so much. So it's a relatively, relatively new. And I think that it's perfectly fine that the award shows are reaching back a little further than they normally would. Blood Quantum, I remember when Blood Quantum came out in what I think it was 2019. It was praised quite a bit. And I think we'll start with that one because it's the only English language, well, not entirely, mostly English. It's
right.
There's a lot, in a couple of these films, we have a mixture of English and the native language. But Blood Quantum is a zombie picture.
Yay!
But it's got a twist that I quite appreciated because I watch a lot of zombie pictures.
Yes,
you do. Zombie TV. And there's a time when you just look at it and go, okay, it's a zombie picture. You're always looking for something fresh, always looking for something new. You're always looking for something to make the concept is going to be the same, but the details, finding ways to engage an audience with new details in a zombie picture. Do you do a zombie comedy? Do you do a zombie romance? Do you, I mean, they, you know, all these different spins. What's interesting about Blood Quantum is that it firmly falls into a lot of the things I don't like about zombie movies. But it manages to put interesting spins on some of the things I don't like, which while I still dislike them, I appreciate the fact that there's a different spin on it. For example,
okay,
the premise of the film, and how spoilery we're gonna get here. I mean, obviously with new stuff, we always try and stay spoiler light, but I suspect we're gonna tread into spoiler territory here, folks. So be warned. But the premise, of course, is that there's a zombie outbreak. And of course, the usual things happen, but it also happens to have the little wrinkle that if you happen to be a Native American, you're immune. Now, first of all, this is an interesting new twist because generally speaking, immunity in the zombie apocalypse is a rarity in most stories, but also the turnaround, of course, perspective and authority are the vast majority of our characters in this film are Native American. And they are keenly aware, made aware at various points, and the audience is made aware of the disparity between the white people in the community and the Native American people in the community. The feelings of some members of the Native American community towards their white neighbors. There's a certain, I mean, there's history here. And if you are at all familiar, of course, with Native American history, you know that there was a whole lot of, oh, let's just say very bad things done to Native Americans over American history. It's one of the darker parts of our country's history. And not just here in the States, also the film is, it's a Canadian film, that Canada has its own history with that as well. So, hey, you know, the zombie apocalypse is here. And it's only the white folks who are getting it. Well, not only the white folks, but Native Americans are immune. Now, Blood Quantum, if you're not familiar with what the title actually means, it actually has to do with the percentage of blood that makes someone their ethnicity and how it's considered. So if you are X amount of the blood quantum, you are white, black, Asian, Native American, et cetera, et cetera. It is also not a great piece of history. It's a whole lot of people trying to determine how they're better than somebody else. Yeah. Unpleasant nastiness. However, it does make the title work very, very well. Of course, it's there's a lot of blood in this movie, and there's a certain amount of getting back at the oppressor built into certain of the characters' viewpoints. Not every character, there's a wide range of character viewpoints in this film. Some white, some Native American, some angry, some resigned, some afraid. Some full of a lot of anger for their against the other, period. And one of the things I greatly appreciated about this film is that in most post-apocalyptic zombie movies, humanity is just awful. They are just the most, you know, hey, it's the zombie apocalypse. We can be the worst human beings we can be. And there are arguments for that in this film and reasons why certain characters become that kind of person. They're not good arguments. They're still horrible. But there's a logic, an internal logic to their argument. The character Lysol has a lot of anger in him. That anger turns it before the zombie apocalypse. Afterwards, he becomes this character from so many zombie films that just is, you know, us
he's
versus...
He's tropey, but at the same time, I thought he did a really good job of kind of leaning into that, making it his own. And I'm going to out myself again for probably the third time as having seen the whole Twilight series, but he's one of the kids in the Twilight movies. And so for me, you know, who are all like in the Twilight movies, kind of happy-go-lucky, mm-hmm. big puppies, really, and who just happen to like, you know, wrestling with vampires. So here's me having seen him in the Twilight series as happy-go-lucky little Embry, and then over here, he is such an a-hole. Like, wow. Who knew the kid could actually act? I thought it was nice contrast.
Well, and there's he does a fantastic job. This is another one. One of the things I want to say about all these films is there are no bad performances as far as I was concerned. I think everybody just did a fantastic job. There's no, sometimes you come across a film and it's like, wow, this person is just a weak link. But that's not the case in any of these pictures. His anger comes from a place you can understand.
For sure.
His rage, his violence, his bitterness. Yes. He looks at the history of his people in relationship to the white people around them, how they're living, his relationship with his father, which is very strained because it's barely a relationship at all. He's a troubled kid. He's turned into a troubled man. And there's a background and a logic to his behavior, reprehensible though it is, that makes a lot more sense than just, we're with the military, the zombie apocalypse has happened, we must become evil. You know, it's like, okay, hang on.
No, he's got a rich history that helps you understand why he might go the direction that he did.
And there's a certain amount of, and he's not the only one in the community who gets a certain amount of, let's get ours back. Mm. And, you know, discovering that shift in power, essentially, that comes from the fact that the only safe place to be is on the reservation. Or the safest place to be. It's not safe there either. And the dynamic that comes when, you know, there's a scene where a white man and his sick daughter come to the gate asking for help. And it is, you know, there's a clear case of Lysol looking at him and going, tough white guy. But there's also, you know, and there's the recognition among the other people in this settlement that it's, you know, look, we have to deal with the fact that we're vulnerable. And the people inside, you know, aren't just Native Americans. There are folks who are susceptible to the virus inside. And there's the cold logic of looking at someone saying, yes, we'd love to be able to bring this sick child inside, but this sick child is sick because she got bit, which means she can't come in. And
she's going to turn, and that's a liability.
Right. And one of the interesting things about this film is that there are a bunch of main characters. And while the film follows one of them for long enough to make you think this person is the main character of the film, Sheriff Trainer, the film doesn't, spoilers, the film plays fair with the idea that everyone is in danger all the time. And
it's got a George R. R. Martin. Is that his name?
Game of Thrones?
Yes. I was like, it's got a very Martin-esque approach to character development.
Yeah, it's fair. And you, I mean, and you have certain stock characters. You've got the sheriff, you've got not bad, but rebellious son. You've got his unacknowledged or barely acknowledged and definitely messed up son, Lysol, from a relationship he had when he was younger. He's got an ex-wife who's a nurse. You've got the members of the community. And his son, Joseph, has a white girlfriend who he's gotten pregnant. And this has caused some tension in the community. And you know, but the two of them actually care about each other. This is a teenage relationship which has some weight to it. And you are introduced to these characters in scenes that establish who they are, give you the chance to breathe with these characters. Again, coming back to those spending time and quiet moments. And yet throughout from very, very early on, I think pretty much the first shots of the film, you know something's wrong.
Yeah, they don't waste any time. I kind of liked that about the movie.
Because fish, generally speaking, when they get gutted, stop moving. And it's another film where we don't see this often, very, very often in zombie films, there where the animals actually can get the virus as well.
Yes.
Not all animals, apparently. Deer are immune, but fish very much stay out of the water, kids. But there's a great scene with a chainsaw. There's animated sequences in the film, which, depending on how you interpret them, changes part of the ending. You know, there's a scene at the end, you watch it and you go, but did that actually happen? I kind of want it to have happened.
So, I mean, one thing that we haven't yet brought up is that not all of these movies that we'll be discussing today are particularly scary. And I would even go so far as to say maybe one or two of them don't even deserve to be considered horror. This one, while I didn't find it particularly scary, it is pretty darn gory.
Mm-hmm.
And it was interesting to me because the level of gore that you see here, you typically only get with movies that are I would go so far as to say exploitation flicks, really. Ones that are kind of even silly, like
mm-hmm.
the splatstick movies are really where you right. only typically see gore of this level. So if gore's not your thing, this movie's not going to be for you. But what I really liked was they've got the gore factor super amped up, and it's well done. Mm-hmm. But the tone of the movie is fairly serious. Mm-hmm. It's not a silly movie like you would expect to see with the kind of gore that is being displayed on screen. And I really dug that combination. And I just, you don't see that happen very often anymore where you get both together. So I really liked that part about the film. And another thing that hasn't been mentioned is the scenery is just
it's gorgeous.
Beautiful. Mm-hmm. I think it was shot in Quebec and in New Brunswick. And it's like, I think Americans probably overall tend to underappreciate, the natural beauty of probably our own country, to be quite fair, as well as the natural beauty of our friends to the north in their country. So it's just, it's so pretty. It's kind of, it's a reservation. So a lot of the buildings that you see are humble and a little run down. And there's just not a whole lot of, there's no splendor really,
right.
other than the natural landscape itself. And it's just so many of the shots are beautiful. And you see that sort of interspersed with the gore. And I thought it was interesting. The other thing that I don't want to be too spoilery here either, but you made the point that with a lot of zombie movies, it tends to become repetitive over time. I think I can't remember the last time we were talking about maybe the Gates of Hell series, one that happened on the island.
Right. Yeah. Zombie. I think it was Zombie.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you're right. I think you and I talked about, I was like, it just got to the point where it's like, oh, look, there's more zombies. They're walking towards you and they're going to get you and you need to run.
Oh, no, zombies.
Been there, done that. Right. Ad nauseum. And what I'm really looking for in my horror movies, particularly in zombie movies, is show me something I haven't seen before. And there is a scene in which our sheriff goes out to visit a couple of heavy drug users to do a wellness check. And the male counterpart of the couple is outside and he's not making sense. He's clearly amped up on something and spouting something about his better half, maybe not being so better. And Sheriff goes in to check on her. And what you see is horrible. It's over the top horrible. It's something I hadn't seen before. And I was like, well, they went where many other zombie films have not dared to go.
And it's not the only film in these collection of movies where we go there.
So I know.
Let's, without being too spoilery, yes, it's a very graphic scene. It's a very disturbing scene. And it's also one of the moments of the film where you get a very real sense of how scared some of these characters actually are. There comes a point later in the film where there's almost a resignation to things. Mm-hmm. There's a character just can't go on and commit suicide. And Trailer's response to finding out that there's a guy who's reanimated inside the camp, inside a bathroom stall, is just... He couldn't use a gun like a sensible person. And he's just, he's just so matter of fact about it. There's this level of,
Yeah.
It's another day at the office. That's not this scene. And there's just, you could, the performance is really fantastic because he just really, you know, his reaction to this is exactly what you would expect. Michael Gray Eyes is the actor. And he does a really fantastic job throughout the entire film. He's a character who, trailer doesn't emote much. A lot of his emotion comes through in his dialogue, in the way he says things, but his face is very controlled.
Yeah, he's stoic.
But there's you can tell by what he's saying and how he's saying it, how he really feels about things. So there's a depth of character that you don't always get from someone who is so deliberately keeping his expression controlled, except for moments when he's not, like, you know, this particular scene we're talking about, where you could just see his eyes just, you know, it's this is what scared looks like in someone who is trying really, really hard to never let anyone know he's feeling anything.
Well, I mean, he's the de facto leader of the community.
Mm-hmm.
And things are falling apart. And I think he's realizing, I mean, first of all, he's a sheriff. So you don't get to be a sheriff by letting yourself panic in situations that have gone sideways. But I think he's playing a role for the community,
mm-hmm.
that these are tough times. We're really only going to get through this together. Let's all put our best feet forward collectively. I mean, ultimately, in a lot of ways, this is a story about community. And what does community mean? And when do you welcome others into that community? And when do you not?
Mm-hmm.
Which is interesting, because I think that theme plays out in Bacurau as well.
The way that these films all play into each other.
Crazy, right?
There's all of these films are political.
Yes.
All of these films have something to say about relationships. All of these films have something to say about history.
Mm-hmm.
It's real. I mean, it's, I don't, there's a through line to this particular selection of films, which, if intentional, excellent series of choices. If unintentional, it tells you something about the kind of films that people are making right now.
Yes, exactly.
And I think that some of it, of course, comes from where you are. Sputnik is set during a certain period of Russian history, right? That shapes what the movie is, what's going to be happening in the film. Blood Quantum is set now-ish.
Yeah, present.
But the history of the Crow Reservation and the people on it and their relationship with their neighbors colors everything. There's all these different, and yeah, it's an extremely solid, well-made zombie picture. It's one of the better zombie films I've seen in a while.
Agreed.
And a lot of that comes out of the performances, because zombies are zombies. Now, although I have to say, the zombies in this are moderately clever. They're not like, you know, tool users, but they also are not, you know, You get a show like The Walking Dead where a zombie encounters a tree and just kind of bump into it forever. These things move quick and they sit there and go, aha, this is in my way, and they go around it, which is not good for our heroes, but it makes for a more visually interesting experience. But so much of it is just, I mean, it's a zombie movie. Here's zombies. Okay. But it's the characters. It's the situation. And it's the way the story develops. I think that this film does a really, really fantastic job of. And yeah, it's gory in a often, well, the chainsaw bit. The chainsaw bit. New chain.
I mean, well, I thought The wood chipper on the bridge was also really great.
There's humor in this film in, I'm not going to quite say it's gallows humor, but it's close.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're willing to sit there and find the humor in the darkest moments.
Sure.
And I think that works out really, really well.
Yeah, I appreciated that too.
So again, fantastic entry, definitely worthy competitor for a best of. Bacurau.
Yeah, I had a hard time with this movie the first half. But then the second half, I decided, I really kind of love this movie.
So imagine, if you will, you're a town. You get up one morning and you discover that your town is no longer on Google Maps. Your town has just disappeared. You're like, well, that's odd. And then what looks like a flying saucer comes by.
There's some weird things happening to those people.
And you're like, what is going on? Then some strangers come to town. This has been described as a weird Western. This is a horror film in the same way that a lot of films based on The Most Dangerous Game, which is definitely a descendant. This is that weird, warped descendant of the Most Dangerous Game, you know, where man hunts man. And there's a certain amount of the weird Western to this, that sort of subset of fantasy where you basically take the Western concept and you splice something else onto it. Now, this is set in modern day. Obviously, like we mentioned, they find out that they're not on the internet anymore. The town has disappeared.
They all of a sudden stop getting cell signal.
And this is not the most high-tech town structurally, but the people there are modern people in the world we live in. They have cell phones. They've got tablets. They've got the internet. They are connected to the world. It's not the richest environment, but it is their home, and
it's a little, like, they're in Brazil. It's a little town, village type thing. The people are not wealthy by any stretch. There are some landowners who have maybe slightly nicer ranch houses type things. But this is rough, raw country.
Mm-hmm.
Cactus. The whole thing recalled to mind for me, West Texas. You know, you expect to see tarantulas crawling and, you know, Gila monsters or what have you. I mean, it's rough country. They are a humble people. They are, the clothes that they wear, it's intermixed, kind of tattered, worn out, wife beatery type shirts mixed with current Adidas pants. I mean, it's that kind of thing where you can see they're influenced by modern style. You get some old women who have purple hair or red hair. And so there's definitely an influence of the modern culture on them, but it's this kind of remote little village in Brazil, and they don't really have a lot, but they have each other, strong sense of community.
Mm-hmm.
Like we were just talking about, they have a DJ who, in my mind, sort of fulfilled the role of Greek chorus, because he plays this role of like sort of commentating on the things that are going on in the town as they're going on. The movie starts out with a funeral of the town village matriarch, and that's where we kind of see him calling out the play-by-play, which I thought was just sort of enchanting, honestly. But I really think it spoke to, it's a humble town, and it's got this strange mix of modern convenience but humble roots.
Mm-hmm. It has also become a target.
Yeah.
They have a bad mayor who is just, he's straight out of the crooked politician school of bad mayors. I mean, he's just all the
things. Yeah, you sort of almost expect him to.
No. There's a thing with water rights. There's all these things. The people of the village are not fans of his. Then the town discovers that they have been chosen someone has paid some other people a large sum of money for this town to become a hunting ground. And Udo Kier, anytime Udo Kier shows up, it's just, Udo Kier, of course, one of the great faces in horror. He's been in so many things. God, Andy Warhol's Dracula, I think where I first saw Udo Kier.
He's one of those guys that, when have I never not known who he was, right? Because he's in so many things.
Yeah. And he's one of those actors. This is a dark film in concept, in a lot of execution, but it's also really funny at times.
It is.
And it's a lot of it comes out. Well, again, this is another film where the performances are just amazing. And when you consider the size of the cast ultimately in this film, there are so many people involved and everybody gets a moment to shine. Even, background characters are only in a scene. They make a presence. This is a really well-crafted and well-shot and well-cast film. But every time Udo Kier is on camera is just, part of me was just like, because he'd say something just, there's a sequence, again, spoiler light, where people are like, did you just shoot something? No, I didn't do that.
I know, I was like, what is that about?
He is just, I mean, it goes on for a while. This is a film, and this is one of the things I really liked about this film, is that there were huge stretches of time when not much happened.
Yes.
And yet I was completely riveted. I mean, the film unfolds at a very interesting pace. There's never a sense of rushing in this movie. There's momentum in the film, but there's never this sense of rush to get to this point or that point.
Mm-hmm.
It was a really, it's an unusual pacing for this kind of film.
100%.
And it worked extremely well.
I struggled with it a little bit. Like I said, I mean, the first half of the movie, I was like, where is this going? Like, what are we doing here? This is a horror movie? What the heck? I was kind of like, I got some other things to do. Can we get on with it? And then finally, when it kicked into gear, I was like, okay, payoff. I appreciate you. Yeah.
And I think that's going to be, you would not get an American film made like this with this kind of story. It would be, the film goes on for an hour or more than an hour, actually, before certain things happen that in an American-made big-budget studio film would have happened at the 30-minute mark no later. And there's a great moment. And the thing is that the payoff of this, again, if you're struggling with the way the film is unfolding, there comes a point where a character turns a corner into a room and looks at a wall. And if you were not suspecting where this story was going already, which I was thinking this is where the story was going to go, but he says a line, I think, what is that? I think the residents are armed.
Yes.
Something like that. And it's such a understatement.
Yes.
And at that moment, I'm like, oh, you guys are all so dead.
You are getting yours just right.
And the payoff is I think well worth it. And yet the story, interestingly enough, doesn't end where you think it's going to end.
Mm-hmm.
It keeps going. I think it's I really liked this film because it surprised me when I didn't expect to be surprised by yet another most dangerous game essentially set up, you know? And I think that I always appreciate that.
Yep. I will say this is another one where there's not a huge amount of gore, again, because we don't start seeing things happen until maybe half, two-thirds of the way through. But when they do introduce gore, it is so well done. There is a scene in which one of the bad guys thinks he's surprising a resident, but doesn't, and gets his. Wow.
Yeah, it uses it well.
It does.
But I would say that this is one of those films, like you mentioned, this is not a horror movie.
You know what? The whole time I was thinking, this seems to me like something that Quentin Tarantino would do.
It's a thriller.
Yeah.
And even then, I would say it's a slow burn thriller. It's not, agreed, you know, but it's not a horror film. I think including it in here on the basis of the manhunting man thing is falls into that often.
It's because of the level of violence in my view. So they said it's a horror movie because it's violent. That doesn't map for me.
Yeah,
but I'm glad I watched it.
I am too. I really enjoyed this film. This was a film that I'm like, okay, I'm never actually scared in this movie. There's no moment of like, well, there were a couple of moments of, but it was more like, oh ho, we're going there, are we?
Yeah.
But no, this is one I think I highly encourage people to watch. It's a very interesting film. Let it breathe at the beginning because the pacing is what it is. But it pays off. But it's not a horror movie. Not really.
Yeah, it just needs to decant a little bit, and then it opens up and you'll enjoy it.
And Udo Kier is just so much demented fun in this film.
Yes.
And that's always a good thing as far as I'm concerned.
I agree with you.
Impetigore. All right, folks, I'm going to get it out of the way. There are Muppets in this movie.
Take a drink, Mr. Harvey. Where's your hot tea? Okay, thank you.
Big gulp of coffee there. All right. There are at least three Muppets in this movie. Actually, there's more than three. They are not adorable Muppets. Kids, there are creepy children in the film of Impetigore. This is an Indonesian horror film, came out in 2019. And this is another film I quite enjoyed. And it goes places you don't expect it to go. It ends in a way I didn't see coming.
Mm-hmm.
In that particular manner, there's a certain amount of, well, of course that's what happens, but oh, that's how it happens. Okay. And it's about, again, about history. It's about community. It's about relationships. It's a very interesting horror film. And this is a horror film. This is a straight up haunted place, cursed people kind of film. The casting of this film is, again, a real strength of it. There are some Tara Basro, who plays the lead, Maya, and her friend Marissa Anita plays, Dita is the character, Marissa Anita is her friend, Dini. Their chemistry, I think, is just comes across actually as people who are friends.
Yeah, it's adorable. They start out the movie where both of them are manning toll booths, separate toll booths, away from one another, but they're on their cell phones chatting with one another. And it's kind of locker room talk, mm-hmm. I would almost say. As a woman, I can tell you that sometimes with your really close girlfriends, you do kind of have conversations like that. Shock, surprise, I know. But sorry to make you realize that maybe we're not all perfect. But I thought it did such a good job.
I don't believe it at all.
But I thought it did such a good job of really setting them up, to your point, to seem like they really actually liked one another. They pick at each other, they poke at each other, they make fun, they get impatient, and they do seem really close. It was an adorable relationship that plays out later.
Yes, yeah. Because their night does not necessarily end well, as there is a man who has kept coming back through the toll booth more than once. And this is making Maya a little bit nervous because, you know, creepy people coming in. You know, she's a lone woman in a little box made of not particularly strong glass and metal. There is no one really around her. They're getting ready to, in fact, this particular toll booth is getting ready to be closed down because it doesn't get enough traffic. So she's fairly isolated when the guy comes back through and then pulls over after he goes through and gets out of his car with a big knife.
And he, like, she sees him. She sees the car park. She sees him get out of the car. She's on the phone already with her girlfriend. She's like, send help. And the guy, you see him advancing, but it's done slowly enough that it really amps up the, this is really happening. Oh my gosh, he's coming after her. Get out. Mm-hmm. And you feel all of that with her as she's going through it. I thought it was super, super well done. What a great way to start out a movie. What a great way to start out a movie.
Well, and it's very, very easy to get the relationships wrong. We've talked about horror films before. You can talk about horror films forever, where you've got this group of people who are thrown together who are supposed to be friends who you don't believe it. So when it comes to them being in danger, you kind of don't care. Mm-hmm. This is a sense where because you've already had these moments, these very brief moments that are very well done to establish the relationship between these two, you know that there's a person on the other end of the line who is worried for her friend, and there's nothing she can do about it. You know, she's called the police, but that's all she can do. And so when Maya gets out of the toll booth and runs, she's alone, and this guy is chasing her, and he gets on top of her, and he says, just leave us alone. And she's like, I don't know what you're talking about. And then the police arrive and they kill him. it sold us the first few minutes of the film. So you've already gone to this place of tension and threat. And you come to learn that Maya has essentially, she was raised by her aunt and she doesn't really know what happened to her mother and father. She's from a village that, you know, she's never been to since she was taken away from it. And really doesn't know much about her own history. And that this of course has opened up this question about, you know, her origins, where, you know, where is she from? And why did this guy call her by a different name? And in the grand tradition of every horror film that you know is not going to end well, she and her friend set off for this village to get answers. And everyone lived happily ever after.
The end.
This is not what happens.
Yeah.
there are moments, again, there are moments where there is a lot of humor. And it comes from the interaction between these two. They're exploring this abandoned house that apparently was her house when she lived in when she was a child. It's like all kinds of fun questions like, well, what is this? I don't know. I just got here too. what happened to all the things? I don't have any idea. I mean, this is the questions we all ask, and that friend that looks at you and goes, I walked in here with you. How am I gonna know the answer to your question? Stop.
And they're in this it's a creepy abandoned house, right? And they're in this village where they don't know anybody, and the villagers are kind of suspicious and not particularly helpful or forthcoming. So they're in this kind of creepy house. Again, they don't know anything about the house. Why is it empty? Why is this nice house just standing here? Why hasn't someone claimed it?
Why isn't come and cleaned out all this really nice furniture?
Exactly.
Still in the house.
And then there you see suddenly in the doorway this shrouded figure, and it's super creepy. And you're like, oh my gosh, here's where things are going to start to take a turn. No, it's her girlfriend in a blanket and scares her. It was hilarious. I was like, okay.
Why are you wearing that? Well, I found it in a drawer and wrapped in plastic.
Yeah. Like, okay, that was funny.
Yeah, and I think that the chemistry between these two is so strong, and it works so well that when bad things starts to happen to our characters, it matters, which is always nice in a horror film.
Because
yes. If you care about the characters, yes, the more you're afraid for the characters. And this is one of the things where, you know, it's really, really easy to get wrong, and a lot of horror films do. There's nothing worse for pulling me out of a film to sit there and go, God, I hope these characters die soon.
Yeah.
And this is not one of those films. They build up the two actresses do a fantastic job of coming across as friends, which makes the danger they are in that
makes it
much
more laughable,
worse.
Right? Yeah.
Because this town has a history. There's bad things happening in this town. Children are dying young, let's say, often minutes after birth. And there's a reason, and there's a history.
And it's a complicated history. Like, it takes a minute to wrap your head around what's really going on here.
So when the history is fully revealed, this is one of those areas, folks, where spoilers really are gonna... I don't want to go there for you, because it, how things play out actually matters. But when this history is first revealed, I had to watch it twice.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm like, hold on, wait, okay.
There were a couple
there were a couple of relationships that didn't quite gel the first time. And then the second, I'm like, okay, I see where we are now. Okay, cool. Please proceed. But Suffice it to say that one of the reasons they think they're going to be able to get answers from the people in town is that there is a resident in this town who is a renowned shadow puppet performer. Now, we had shadow puppets in the last episode.
I know. I was like, wow.
I am all on board with more shadow puppets because apparently they turn out to be creepy. Who knew? And I think it works really, really well. So coming into this community and asking questions, they have a way. It's like, well, my friend is doing a college thesis on, you know, puppetry and
on shadow puppets.
Yeah,
yeah, so that's why we're here.
And it's a suspicious town. They have reasons to be suspicious. They have reasons to be how they are, I suppose.
Yeah.
Not great ones when you think about it. And that's actually brought up in the film where, why would you believe this? Because they're the ones in authority? The person at the top tells you what to believe. And suddenly an entire town becomes...
They are a simple, humble people whose lives are being controlled by this really terrible curse that's been placed on them. And they're doing the best they can to make sense of it and to try to overcome it. But it's really outside of their control in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes this outsider, Maya, with the historical roots, but the outside perspective to be able to put the pieces together and bring about the resolution that is semi-resolved, but not really, because when do horror movies ever really 100% tie up with a nice, neat bow? But I don't think that this sort of, I'm believing you because you're the village elder, works outside of a village elder setting. So I think that's why, for me, I didn't get hung up on that. I felt like it worked, given the setting.
Yeah. Robert over on our YouTube chat, Robert Hubbard has been providing us, by the way, and thank you, Robert, has been providing us a lot of cool suggestions. I've got a whole bunch of them that he sent me after the last episode. And we're going to be incorporating some of Robert's stuff and suggestions into some of our later shows. And he's getting a chance to watch us live this episode. Welcome, Robert.
Hi, Robert.
But thank you, sir, for providing some really great suggestions. I am kind of crappy on social media sometimes for not responding, and my apologies about that. But I always appreciate the suggestions. Robert's got a depth and breadth of movie knowledge, which is greatly appreciated. So thank you, sir. There's this film. One of the things I appreciate about the film is that the horrible things that the townspeople believe turn out to be true, but it's not the whole story. There's another layer to this, so that when it actually is revealed what's going on here, there's more to it than just, you know, and here's the reason for the curse. It's like, aha, but wait, there's more.
Yeah.
And it actually makes the story stronger, I think. And in many ways, the worst villain of the film is pretty clear from early on. Once you get into the town, the worst monster in the film is not the curse. The worst monster is the person who ultimately put the curse in motion. And you know, this matriarch in the village who just rules over everything with a not so obvious iron hand. You don't necessarily see her it builds on you a little bit just how much control she has.
And
there are moments of violence in this film that are sudden and shocking. It saves its gore. It saves its violence up until, I mean, you get the machete attack early on in the film, very early on in the film. But then a long period of time goes on before you get into real violence. And the violence is quick and brutal, which I always find more effective than the drawn out, you know, Eli Roth school of violence. But, and then you get a couple of scenes, you're like, you went there. Okay.
Yeah, I felt like the violence itself was kind of uneven, which I guess is okay. I mean, there's no rule that says that, you know, you've got to approach your violence like with 5 minutes between each. But it was really interesting to me how like the film hits you from the beginning, but then it backs off and it says, okay, now from this point, I'm going to do a slow burn up until, you know, the last 20 minutes or whatever. And I liked that about it. This is another one where it gives you, as you said, time to breathe with the characters and figure out who they are. And it's not just the two main characters that you get to know a little about. It's also the more extended inhabitants of the village that you learn a little more about. You end up finding out later on that there's this thread between the man who attacks Maya at the beginning of the film to what's going on, which I thought was really well done and clever, and I'm not going to ruin it for anyone. And I also thought it's just these little details that you don't realize are being dropped into the slow pacing of the movie that kind of tie into the end. Like there's one point at which when they first arrived in the house, Maya's sitting down, like looking through pictures. Mm-hmm. And she says, there are no pictures of me. And you don't really think anything about it. You think, oh, that's weird. And it wasn't until I was going through my notes, as I always do in preparation for you and I to chat today, that I went, oh, yeah, that makes sense. So it was just, it's smart. I thought it was a smart movie. I thought maybe it's a smart movie that talks about, again, it's politics, class warfare in a lot of respects, interfamilial, intergenerational violence and control and the hurts that we do to each other is really what ultimately this movie is about, I think.
There's a sins of the father.
Yeah, absolutely.
idea behind this of the evil done in previous generations and how it does damage to those that follow.
Yeah.
And it ends up being there comes a critical moment when certain relationships are revealed where the power of certain words that you expect, that you hear among families, take on a different meaning in the context of suddenly the revelation of who these people are to each other in a way that you didn't see before. And I think it ends up being a solid, nice, creepy... There are surprises in the film, but structurally it's not that surprising, right? It's and certainly you get to the end of the film and it's got a very, I would say, what you consider to be a modern horror film ending.
I kind of didn't like that modern horror ending. I was like, you guys were really doing pretty good not being cliche up until that point, and then you lop that on the end, and I was like, you could have done without that.
I think the film could have done perfectly fine without that ending. I didn't mind the ending because I think it just sort of perpetuates the fact that this generational evil isn't necessarily neatly tied up in a bow. And it kind of really, again, defines who the true villain of the film always was. But yeah, it's feels a little bit like a Hollywood ending.
Mm-hmm.
Now, sometimes when you say Hollywood ending, it means that the boy and the girl end up riding off into the sunset. This is not that movie.
No.
The last time we see our heroine is not usually how you see most movie heroines' stories particularly end. I thought it was a nice touch, actually, that the way she exits the film is kind of very much how she started the film, running in terror and just wanting to be away from the thing that is after her. And it's a little different, and it's definitely different by the end of the film. But this is a film, again, really, really happy I watched it. Really quite enjoyed it a lot. And just really solid, strong performances all the way around. Especially from the people that you, who could just be cartoon villains, or very stereotypical villains, who end up having a lot more depth to them and more interest, and definitely great screen presences. Certain puppet makers.
And I thought that the residence that had been abandoned was an interesting building. But this is another one of those movies where it's a foreign film. I'm going to say this 3 billion times before we ever finish the show. I like movies that make me feel like I've been transported mm-hmm. away from America. And this was a movie that made me feel that way because these are people who are living very differently. I would say that's really been true for every single movie that we've talked about today that was up for, that was a nominee for the Chainsaw Award. Every single one of them felt like not American, not in America. Right. And this one, it's like Bacurau in the sense that you get lots of really beautiful views of the landscape. But what's different about Bacurau is it's really raw and scrubby, cactusy, deserty. But then with Impetigore, where it's in Indonesia, it's raw, but it's lush mm-hmm. and it's rainforesty and trees and just lots of undergrowth and very green. Mm-hmm. And some of the shots where they're following the women as they're walking through the village, walking to the village, really just, I thought, beautifully done and really showcased that part of the world very beautifully.
Well, and I think we have a chance to go inside what is a relatively enclosed community, which has been carrying the weight of this experience, you know, the damage that's been done to this community for a long period of time. And it shows, it allows you to be somewhat sympathetic with some of the characters who you don't necessarily want to be sympathetic with, because there are times when they kind of come across as, you know, the, you know, very paranoid, very antagonistic, very much a danger to our characters. But at the same time, again, a lot of this is pacing and how characters are introduced and how much time you spend with some of the ordinary people in the village to sort of get a sense of how trapped they are, how trapped they feel, and how this sense of fear and this curse that hangs over them can make people do terrible things. And there's some weight to the story, which I think actually works really, really well in its favor. Because generally speaking, you don't get a whole lot of American films where you have like a multi-generational curse at this scale. And so I really appreciated just this, again, different kind of social myth, social folklore, the kind of things that you see a lot more in Eastern culture than you get in Western culture. So this was another nice thing, another thing that we just don't see a lot here. Mm-hmm. And again, performances in this film were just fantastic. And it's shot extremely well. It's a beautiful, beautiful film, even in the moments of brief and sudden violence.
Yes.
And there's a shot where you see someone, the camera rotates, and you see a character who is hanging upside down, and the camera turns and their face becomes righted in the image, and it just makes it worse in a good bad violence way.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was a very effective camera move and a very effective sequence. And yeah, again, really, really enjoyed this film. La Llorona, this is not Curse of La Llorona, different movie. This is a political film. This is a film about politics and culture and family. It is a ghost story. Is it a horror film? Yes and no. It's a ghost story. It's about being haunted. It's not being haunted by the sins of the past. You could pull the supernatural element out of this story and the film would hold up.
It's about angry chickens coming home to roost.
Yes. And it's about the lies you tell yourself.
Mm. Yes.
To survive the world you're living in. And generations of women who are dealing with the violent acts of a few men who lust for power. It is a really so the essential premise is here we have a dictator who has been thrown out of power, and he's on trial for his crimes, war crimes. He's responsible for killing the indigenous Mayans, thousands of them. It's almost a genocidal result, certainly a genocidal intent. And he's this little frail old man who looks like you could push him over just without any thought. A stiff breeze is going to blow the guy away. And yet he wields this kind of power and this kind of threat. And his wife and his daughter and her daughter and know, his wife is what, in her 70s, and a daughter in her 30s, and youngest daughter is what, no more than 12, I'd say. And the grandmother sits there and she's like, well, you know, all these accusations are just lies. People have been paid to say these horrible things about our family. And her daughter is kind of like, sure, Mom. And the young daughter just doesn't know why everyone hates them so much. Yeah. Why can't they just leave? Why can't they just go away from this place where everyone hates them? And this is another film where the pacing is just, this film does not unfold in a quick manner. It is deliberate. It is, I'm not going to say even, because there's moments where it definitely isn't. But this is a slow, slow burn movie. This is a film where you can literally spend a minute, minute and a half just looking at someone's face on the camera. While other things are happening off camera, there's a scene in an ambulance where the camera is just focused on mother, maiden, crone. There you go. And the middle of the women is just, the camera just stays on her for like a really long time while these other things are happening. And you're just, there's a lot of that in the film where you're just soaking in atmosphere of what's happening around these people. Because when all is said and done, they're inside this house that's surrounded by protesters because the trial, the judiciary overthrows the guilty verdict. And they're almost, it's a siege movie at this point, but it's a slow motion siege. And they're trapped inside this house with all these people outside protesting them. And it's like a pressure cooker. And then a new house servant comes.
And you know from the moment that she shows up that she's going to play a destabilizing influence on what is already a family whose structure is beginning to crumble. Oh. I mean, they aren't. I thought it was real for me. I thought the movie had a lot of subtlety about it, but they didn't really pussyfoot around the fact that the appearance of the new house servant, Alma, things were going to transpire because of that.
Oh yeah. And this is a film where there are a lot of characters who say very little.
Mm-hmm.
There is a lot less dialogue in this film than you would necessarily expect. But what is there is really, really powerful. And some nightmare sequences, some dream sequences, which really become and are triggered by the arrival of Alma. By the way, Maria Mercedes Caroy is the actress who plays Alma. And this is a lady whose blank expression just...
It's unnerving.
It's, yeah. She just looks at you and you're like, right, I'm sorry. There's a weight to it, which I think is really, especially for the part she's playing, is really effective. And just, there's a... The supernatural elements creep in a way that you don't necessarily recognize initially. Alma starts helping the youngest daughter hold her breath. And there's a reason for that. Water starts to figure very, very strongly in the visual aesthetic of the film. Whether it's someone losing control of their bladder or hallucinating the floor being flooded. And there's a reason for the repeated use of water and the sense of losing control. And all of these pieces come together in a way that, again, falls back into this multi-generational group of women who are accepting and facing the responsibility. There's an interesting sense of trying to define who is responsible. The person who actually pulls the trigger or the person who lets them pull the trigger. And there's a certain amount of complicity, especially with the dictator's wife. His daughter less so, his granddaughter in
She's
no
an
way.
Innocent. Yeah. But
there's a certain amount of recognition on the part of the wife, of forced recognition on the part of the wife, that she has not been looking at the people her husband was responsible for killing as people. And I think there's an effectiveness to her arc that I liked. And yet I found the ending a little abrupt.
Hmm. So for me on this one, you know, I think that with a lot of horror films that are out there, they would be better films if there was a little more care and restraint exercised on the part of the director and probably even the editor, right?
Mm-hmm.
I, in this one, felt that they perhaps went too far. I appreciated what they were trying to do, that they were trying to create a subtle, atmospheric, moody, sad. It's a sad movie.
Mm-hmm.
But I felt like this was one where the pacing was just, I have a fair tolerance for spacing, pacing, but this was one where I just felt like,
pick it up.
I could we maybe have cut 10 minutes out of this movie and sped things up just a wee little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate the subtlety. I just thought it could have been a little bit tighter and we would have gotten the same movie. And I would have been a little less bored, honestly. It just felt a little art house, like more art housey than it.
Okay, it's very art house.
Yeah,
this is a very art house film. It's shot beautifully. I mean, the cinematography is very well crafted. You know, the lighting, especially there are times in the film when the lighting is extremely evocative. But it's very much an art house horror film.
Yeah.
And it's, I'm sorry, art house ghost story.
When I say it's a little art house, what I mean is it's a little too art house for my taste. I don't mind movies that pull that in.
Mm-hmm.
But when that's the primary focus and the storytelling is kind of slow and draggy, that's when I speed things up a bit. But what I appreciated about this movie is exactly the piece that you highlighted. It's the examination of at what point, and I think this is a really tough social issue everywhere, at what point as a woman do you stop being a victim of the violence and control of the men around you? And at what point do you tip from being victim to being complicit supporter? And this is something for me that I struggle with conceptually, because I do know that, you see, like in cases of child abuse, that you really have to be careful about assigning blame to the woman, because she was probably a victim of violence herself. And they get sort of brainwashed into thinking they don't have any control over the situation. And they have long stopped attempting to interfere. And have also begun, in many cases, participating in abuse of their children. And it's a really tough spectrum of behavior to say, at what point do you, as an outsider, as an objective observer, and an assigner of moral guilt, do you say, you should have stepped in, you should have stepped up, you should have said something, you should have done something? And I think it's easy for us to look at the role that the mother plays and say, you knew what was going on. You chose not to do anything because you enjoyed the lavish lifestyle that your husband was able to provide the family. I think it's really easy to take that position. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it's clear that she has suffered in some ways as a result of that relationship. I think it's easy for us to say that was a bargain that you made with the devil. That was the trade-off. You had a jerk husband, but you got a nice house. These are tricky social issues to pick apart. And I think the movie does a great job of saying, you need to look at this and you need to think about this.
There is a moment in the film where the status of the daughter's husband, who is not in the picture, not in the film, not in his wife or daughter's life, he's just gone. And there's some implication about what happens to those even close to the family who the dictator doesn't care for. And how the dictator decides what he's going to consider to be the history. He creates his own history to excuse things. And there were times when I looked at the mother and said, the wife mother, and said, she could have left at any time, but could she? And there's some interesting family internal and external violence that is going on in this film. There's not a lot of actual violence in this movie. Some of it is just nightmare fuel. and there's, you don't see a lot, but what you know is going on, because genocide ain't pretty, folks. And there are moments of the, there are moments where you see children and you know what is about to happen to them. And then you start to see it. You don't see all of it, but you see enough. It's a fascinating political family drama. And I find it very interesting how much you could completely pull the supernatural angle out of the movie and the film would still hold up. The flip side of that is that it means this really fascinating political family drama doesn't need to be a ghost story or a horror film. So while it is a ghost story, it's not a horror film unless, okay, it is a horror film in the sense that real life horrors are committed.
Yes.
But in the context of what we often think of as a horror film, where there's a supernatural antagonist, or, you know, a serial killer, or the standard horror model, right? It doesn't fit those. But in terms of it, I mean, you, if you're looking at it in the case of the man's inhumanity to man, the evil we do unto our own, how power corrupts, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, yeah, I mean, there's horrors here. But while I don't necessarily have a problem with a slow burn movie, even one this slow, I think you are going to have more patience than a lot of other people who are going into this thinking, this is the film that the Chainsaw Award said was the best foreign horror film of the year.
Yeah.
And I, so here's the question.
Yeah, I was going to ask you. How did you rank these? Did you?
So here's the problem I have. Because best versus enjoyed most.
Mm-hmm. See, so I think I ranked them based on enjoyed most.
Right. So, I mean, enjoyed most, Blood Quantum, to be honest. I just because it's got this wide range of interesting characters, I appreciated its new spin on something I quite frankly, I've seen so much zombie stuff that it takes a lot to surprise me. Mm-hmm. And to give me something new. I really appreciated what they did new wise. So that's the one I probably enjoyed the most. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's the best of them. Probably Bacurau, I think, is the best of them.
But it's not horror.
It's not. But it's the film I think is the best made. And they're all well made. Let's be very clear. These are all really good movies. I enjoyed all of them on one level or another. I appreciated the work. I appreciate the fact that they all have very good reasons for being on this list. There's not a film on this list. I'm like, why is this here? What are you thinking? But in terms of, Impetigore is a really well-crafted ghost story, you know, cursed, you know, ghost story kind of thing. I really, really think it's a good, solid movie in that category. LLORNA, political thriller, family drama, you know, again, really good. Sputnik, classic, you know, things out in space are coming to get you movie, with a slow burn, very Russian feel. But so many films have been done with the most dangerous game, with evil rich people coming to shoot the innocent, you know. I'm suddenly, oh no, and then the tables are turned and things. But very few of them really take the time to build up the characters, build up the environment, build up the villains. We didn't really talk about how much information we get about these villains and how much their characters come through. Doesn't make any of them sympathetic. But they're interesting in a way you're like, I mean, and then you get the last 20 minutes of the movie and you're like, yeah, I mean, so it's not really a horror film, but I think it's the best film on this list.
So here's how I ranked, because why not, right? Mm-hmm. So, and I did it from a did I enjoy it perspective, which is typically how I vote with my heart.
And that's fair. That's a completely justifiable perspective as far as I'm concerned.
I put number one, Blood Quantum. I loved the crap out of that movie. That movie was so fun. Yeah, it just, it well, for all the reasons that have already been stated. Number two, Bacurau.
Mm-hmm.
Number three, Sputnik.
Mm-hmm.
Number four, Impetigore. And number five, La Llorona. Now, to be clear, I don't have any bad feelings about number four and number five. I thought, to your point, they are really solid movies for what they're trying to do. But from a how much I enjoyed them perspective, I just happened to enjoy one, two, and three a touch more.
And quite frankly, I think that that's... I don't know that I would put them in any specific ranking order any differently in terms of liking them. It's interesting because some of these films you look at and you can really appreciate the work went into them. You can appreciate the storytelling. And I mean, I'm glad I watched La Llorona. I appreciate what they did, but I can't say I like super, it's not meant to be an enjoyable movie. You're not meant to enjoy the sense of doom that's settled over this house, right? I mean, it's effective. I appreciate it, but
it's a movie that's really challenging you to consider some pretty deep themes.
Yeah, but I mean, yeah, quite frankly, the two films, and if I'm looking at, they almost fall into the kind of liked them about the same in terms of just enjoyment factor, but for different reasons. I mean, because Blood Quantum, the story, the twist on the zombie genre, that feeling of just, we know what we're doing here and how we're telling this story and how we're developing these characters. That was moments of super darkness they went to. Those moments of comedy that are there. It's, you know, the idea that, you know, this line where the grandfather looks at his grandsons and said, I'm not leaving this land again. I mean, there's power in this story. And in many ways, as dark as the movie goes. And if you want an example of what I mean when I say dark, an equivalent science fiction film is Children of Men. Okay. I mean, this gives is a sense of tone, except there's more humor in Blood Quantum, but only a little bit more. And maybe it's the weird Western part that speaks to me, where, you know, this little town in the middle of nowhere. And I always love an underdog story. You know? Hi there. We're the cocky Westerners with our big guns and our you know, we're
and
so sure.
And desire to shoot something.
And just that, the look on, again, the cast is so big. And they spend enough time with enough people to give you this sense of community. And just the realization when people are realizing what's going on. Just, you know. It's slim. It's really slim that blood quantum comes out on top. In terms
I know. I almost said that they were tied for me, but I was like, I'm going to make myself rank them. Okay.
So definitely, I think Bacurau is the better movie, but enjoyment factor, they're close, super close. So, Chainsaw Awards. I'm not going to say they got it wrong. That was fans voted on that. So by all means, that's what
I'm
won.
A little surprised though that fans. Put La Llorona on top. That does a map for me, but you know, whatever. I think that tells me something about modern audiences that I wouldn't have guessed.
There's a couple of different things that popped into my head when I was considering that is why people would vote for that. And that is, first of all, we're at home. If you were going to a film festival and watching these, if you're going to a, you know, here's the 2-day Chainsaw Award Festival. Everyone come out and watch the films in the theaters together. I think you would have a very different breakdown here with this category. I think Blood Quantum probably would have come out on top if you had been a whole bunch of people watching this in a theater together. Just because we feed off each other in a theater. And when you're sitting at home and watching some of these films, you can get, I mean, I watch it on my 27-inch computer. So it's, you know, or my, however big the TV in the living room is. So I've got this fairly large screen, but I'm by myself. So no one can hear me go, ooh, that's gross, or ooh, that's cool, or oh no, you know, or yeah, if I jump, I'm jumping by myself, but you're in a theater, you get this, you know, you feed off each other. And so I think that for, I'm guessing, I don't know, I don't have any great insight to the world, that La Llorona hit people harder because they were by themselves. And that if they got past the pacing and got engaged with what was going on with the story, the satisfaction of the ending on a spiritual level, I think, might have been appealing. It, you know, there's no way of knowing what number two was on this list. Mm-hmm. But I think with an audience, Blood Quantum and Bacurau would have been the ones where the audience would have been going, yeah, or oh, or no. You would have had that.
Exactly.
And I think that actually, you know, then you would have the question of debating better, best film versus film I enjoyed most.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I think I understand why they went there. Not the choice I would have made.
But still glad I watched it.
Oh yeah. Yeah, this is a definite example of films that there were reasons, all of them had reasons to be on this list. And no complaints about watching them. The question is, which one were you gonna want to watch again at some point in the, you know, a year from now, which one of these films are you gonna sit there and go, yeah, I'm gonna watch that again?
Blood Quantum.
Yeah, definitely.
Definitely.
Impetigore, maybe. I think I'm gonna watch that one again, just to let
I would be interested in going back and watching that one again, simply because of were there little details that were sprinkled that I missed and maybe would catch on a second viewing now that I understand the mystery that was revealed.
Yeah, yeah, I can see that. I think it'll be a while before I watch La Llorona again.
Yeah, I think that one might not ever. I mean, who knows? You don't ever, never say never, but dude, we've got a whole spreadsheet of things to watch. So
I'm sorry. We have a what?
Spreadsheet.
What happened? There we go. All right. I did not even go into the detail about the Muppets.
You didn't.
But I do have to drink again.
Big restraint on your part. I'm proud of you.
The Muppets are a spoiler, though. So.
Truth.
All right, folks. We are coming up on 2 hours on this particular episode. So if you've stuck with us, well, you appreciate it. Definitely, we hope that if you have not seen these films, again, I highly encourage you to check them all out. They're all available online. Most of them are for free. If you happen to be an Amazon Prime user, obviously, that's not completely free. Or they're relatively inexpensive to rent. A lot of them are over on Shudder, if you happen to be a fan, if you happen to use the Shudder service. But definitely worth checking out. There's a reason that we encourage folks to check out foreign films. It's because they're great stories and well-crafted movies, and we just don't get to see them as often. So it's nice to see this sort of thing get exposure over here. And certainly to something as the Fangoria Chainsaw Awards are well-regarded. They are not a, you know, nothing award. So hopefully the exposure that this film gets more people to watch. Because a lot of the people who made these films, this is not their first film. And hopefully that exposes you to more of other cultures' storytelling, whether it's horror or not. We, of course, will talk more about horror films from around the world. If you feel inclined to throw money at us, you can. We'll let you. But it doesn't go into our pockets. We have a Subscribestar. You can actually help, I don't know, pay for our travel to a horror convention. The world is opening back up. I'm getting my second vaccination on Tuesday. I'm really actually rather pleased about that. And that means that we're going to get out into the world. Conventions are going to happen again. There's going to be more horror conventions. There's going to be more horror festivals to go to. We're excited about getting a chance to potentially do that. Should you want to fund sending Leslie and I off to report from a horror film festival, we'll let you. And that would be a cool thing to use. All that money goes in to help make our programming here better. So we appreciate if you can, and if you can't, you know what? We appreciate that you're watching. If you have questions or comments, suggestions, by all means, please let us know. You can find this show right here, and you can find comments and ratings of opportunities below. We appreciate you watching. So where next, Leslie? Where are we going next?
I don't know. We got to figure that out. But, you know, we'll know by the next time we get here.
But there is that. And we have a lot of other countries. If you've been watching our show from the beginning and you have places you think we should go, by all means, please let us know. If there's a pretty good chance, we already have a few films selected from that area. But you know what? We are definitely open to suggestions for places we don't even have on our list yet. Turns out there's a lot of countries in the world. Turns out a lot of them like horror. Turns out a lot of them like making movies. So thank you, Leslie.
Always a pleasure, Mr. Harvey.
And thank you, folks, for watching. We will do this again in a couple of weeks on our next Foreign Bodies.